Thank you for listening to Depictions Media Radio.
Welcome to Policy and Rights, the show about government policy and human rights. Welcome back to Policy and Rights here on Depictions Media Radio. Today, I had an opportunity to talk to another podcaster. His name is Ed Waters. He is out of Oregon, and we didn't exactly totally have a total political or government conversation. But we had a great conversation about people waking up. And part of that conversation was about people waking up so that they will go and vote. As we know, in the United States, they're in the middle of the midterms. And people need to go cast their vote so that they are voting for the representative that supports what it is that they believe in. By definition, a representative should do exactly that. When we think of represent, it's kind of a duplication of or support of what it is that we want to see in our community. And Ed and I, we talked about that. And how we need that in our community. We need people to wake up. We need people to understand what is actually going on. And we also talked about being the moderate, down the middle, not to the extreme right or to the extreme left, but hey, we can have some ideas that are kind of right-wing. We can have some ideas that are kind of left-wing. But we need it all to be there and supported by our representation in government. We need more than just party ideas. We need other independent thought ideas to be there. And that's what makes this interview that I did and this discussion I had with Ed Waters of Dead America, the podcast Dead America, and the blog Dead America, so important. Are we waking up and casting our vote, or are we sleepwalking through life? So listen to what Ed and I talked about for the next episode and decide for yourself about how you're going to wake up and support your community and where you should cast your vote when it comes time to vote again. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Well, welcome to the show, Ed. And first off, Dead America. What brought it to life? I guess it's kind of
yeah.
why'd you get started podcasting and blogging?
Well, first off, Michael, thank you for having me. And you know, the journey of rediscovery and finding myself after a traumatic accident that took my whole livelihood from me, basically, and I felt lost. I felt discouraged. I felt alone, and I felt dead in America. And basically, through conversations that I've been having, I know that I'm not alone, and it really helps encourage this journey that everybody's really on in life. But rediscovery is what started Dead America.
So what was the rediscovery?
Well, the accident that I was involved in that took my ability to work and do the things that I used to do, it really took the sense of manhood away from me. And I really always used my hands and my brawn. I used my brain a little bit, but really not as a way of making a living. And I really figured it's hard to get on a microphone and talk. I thought I would never be here doing something like this. And really, I started just complaining on the internet because I felt wronged. I felt that I got the boot, and I had everything I ever wanted in the job that I had. I made it to the top, and it was a good feeling. And after you lose that, you don't know where to go. My wife, myself, and my pets, we were found without anything because the medical bills, the living expense, it ate the savings very quickly. And I found myself homeless and in a van with my wife. So that sent me into a mental breakdown that I can still remember clearly. I wanted to die. I wanted to kill myself. I wanted assisted suicide. I asked for that. And it took me a long time to discover there's other ways, there's other things. And just because you're broken doesn't mean you can't heal. And that's the discovery part that really needs to sink in when you find yourself in something like that. Because that mental state of mind of poor me, I can't do it, that's self-defeating. So yeah, we've got to look over that and change the way we see life, especially when you can't do the things that you've done before. Are you going to just quit? Or are you going to change your environment, change the way you do things, and learn new things to progress in life? Life's not over until you're in the dirt.
Yeah, yeah. that's very true, right? You know?
Yes.
And, of course, a bad cliche, the fat lady ain't sung yet.
That's right. Yeah. So that is discovery, you know, and finding that wisdom, that knowledge that there is other ways. It's hard to do for a lot of people. It was for me. So I relate with that.
Yeah. Your podcasting is similar to mine, where it isn't representative of, oh, I have this huge glossy coaching practice behind me or any of that kind of stuff. It's, hey, public, wake up. It's like, you know, there's a truth out there that it's bright and shiny, yeah, but you got to wake up and find it, you know. So
that's the discovery right there, Michael.
Yeah.
You've got to wake up to find it. And a lot of people are just sleeping and they're going through their day to day. You know, before I was injured, I was really in this fog and I did not realize the world around me. I was so focused on that everyday need to survive and get the day-to-day done. I didn't have time for the menial things in life. And when that injury happened and I was face-to-face with watching things happen, that's a life changer. And when you slow down enough to actually observe not only yourself, but the people around you, that is life-changing. And it really makes you take heed to why are we here and what is your cause? You have a purpose. Is it just the buck? I don't think so. I think life is much more than just chasing the dollar and fame, fortune. It really is part of the mental health dilemma that we're in today. We get so many different attitudes of the memes, is what I call it. So, yeah, we have to wake up to find it.
Yeah, yeah. And that's the thing is... We look at all the, at least when, for myself, when I look at all the media that's out there, it's like it's about, like you said, chasing a buck. It's like well, there's a lot more out there, and there's so much cynicism to it that it's like, and when I wake up and I look up and it's like, and I'm like. And you smell what's around you, and you see what's around you with the trees, and I got bunnies running around the house and all that kind of stuff. It's like, well, there's got to be more to it than chasing a dollar and taking that same dollar and just giving it away to pay a bill anyway, right? You know, there's got to be more to it.
That's the vicious cycle, isn't it?
Yeah.
Crazy. And that is a sense of, you know, we think that we're getting ahead, but we're doing the same thing day to day. And if we're not aware of that, that is really truly the definition of insanity, isn't it? So yeah. If you're doing the same thing day to day and expecting different results, it's not going to happen. So you've got to reach outside of your box to find the true freedom that you're really seeking. And it doesn't exist with what somebody thinks of you or how much you acquire in this world. The true freedom that we all seek is connection. And with all the negative bickering and arguing and pettiness in our world today, we're just letting that go over us, and we've got to really come back to the center focus and rediscover that meaning of life. And yes, bunnies, I've got some out back here. I've got chickens, you know, it's beautiful to watch nature and just consume something that takes your breath away, you know.
Yeah.
Go out into nature and find a grand waterfall and observe it and take the awe that is there in. It really is invigorating in many, many ways.
Yeah. Well, you know, I've done a few programs on climate action and climate change and things like that, and okay, so one of the conclusions that I came to isn't just about like how much fuel I'm pumping into my truck, because yes, I do still have a gas burning truck. I haven't switched over to electric yet. Maybe I will, maybe I won't, right? But the thing of it is when you really look at it is, it's about the consumerism. If we were to scale back to consumerism, because I look at my neighborhood, and there's little pockets of forest that are around, right? And there's animals living in them. And I'm seeing more and more packs of coyotes just running around the neighborhood. Because I get up and I go for a walk down to the beach and everything, just before the sun comes up. So I catch some stars and I catch a sunrise, right? And I'm like, hey, damn, there's more and more coyotes running around, more and more skunks, raccoons, and all that kind of stuff, where they were in these forested areas. They weren't coming out where the people were. But what we've done is, and this is, I think, part of the whole thing with climate action, that they're not talking about is we're taking away for ourselves the habitat for and the homes for these guys. Don't they deserve a house too? Right? You know, yeah. So to
yeah,
speak.
That's right.
Right? So
yeah. Well, when we talked earlier, we talked about, you know, the encroachment problem and managing it via these viaducts that go over the freeways and giving that habitat a right of way. And I think it's really important that we slow down and observe the habitat and their needs. We've recorded many of these species and the way they live, but yet we continue to encroach upon their needed habitat to, like you just stated, get a quicker, easier life for us. We put a freeway down through some habitat of these species that need that habitat that's no place else on Earth. Mm-hmm. Is that right of us? Should we really be doing that? We're consuming species as we encroach more and more into their habitat. And then we turn around and we complain about they're in our yard. They're wrecking our habitat. You know, so right. We really have to think about that. It's got to be a symbiotic relationship where we meld and we converge together in a meaningful way, because their habitat is just as important as our habitat.
Yeah, yeah. Do you think that this consumerism idea supports that, or is it just going to keep encroaching and destroying? You know. And eventually destroy our planet, you know.
Yeah, well, that's our responsibility to control our vanity, our need, our greed, and yes, our consumerism has been a very big problem for a long time. We've went to disposable. We don't fix things anymore. Once mm-hmm. it's broken, we throw it in the landfill, and then we buy something else that's cheap and going to break. And I think that's a very misleading lifestyle in many ways, because it's not sustainable. Well, eventually, we're going to run out of these essential minerals and assets that we need to supply this consumerism. So I think we really need to rethink how we are allowing corporations to be formed. You know, I'm a stickler on this, because when a corporation was first formed, there was very few and it was limited. And the reason behind these corporations, you know, now it's a free-for-all, and they do their dirty deeds and they dump the company and form a new company. There's a lot of things that need to be addressed here because of our consumerism. And it really is a sore spot in my heart to know that we can't be satisfied with what we have. You know, what the beauty around us can consume you if you just let it. But we have this vanity and we're searching for a fake world, or it's hard to explain, I guess.
Yeah. But
we have allowed our vanity to consume us and allow our consumerism to get out of control. We've got to reel that back in and build some things that are durable, lasting, meaningful, and repairable. That way we're not consuming all of our assets and vital resources around the world.
Yeah. You look at some of the, like you said, when you look at some of the products that we have, everybody's got to get the latest greatest. Wherever the latest greatest, shall we say, this is, you know. So
yeah,
you know, I was talking to my wife today about, we were talking about cell phones, right? And why would it's there? You can lease your cell phone because every 2 years you can swap it out and you have the newest one.
Yes.
It's like I did just buy a new cell phone, but the reason why I bought a new cell phone is because the one I had, the battery wouldn't charge up anymore. Okay, well, that's a good reason to go get another one. It's no longer fixable, right? Exactly.
Mine is all broken up. The screen's cracked. But it works, and the good phone stays in the office, and when I use it, it's for this reason. So I have an iPhone, which is, you know, a pretty expensive little thing, and I refuse to pack one with me. It's this cheap little Android thing, but this thing's like 4 years old now, and it still works, so there's no reason for me to just go get the latest and the greatest. So we've got to change that mentality about us. And yeah, that's a hard one to really wrap our minds around because of the way our world is presented to us. You know, the mass marketing, the media, they push this consumerism and the glam in our lifestyle instead of the true meaningful, you know, have a picnic with your family and get to know one another and talk to them and have a baseball game. We used to go out and run and play and have fun. My mother would pitch the ball and we would have baseball games, you know. And it's now nobody wants to go outside. They want to sit here and be on these machines, and it's a different world. But you know, in a way it's helped us, and in a way it's been a hindrance. So we've got to find that balance, that medium. And with this technology really being so new, it really is, we're still finding that balance and understanding how we should use these technologies in good, meaningful ways.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll be honest with you. You bring up the idea of a picnic and everything. It's like my wife and I, we go on a regular picnic. It's like we were like kind of disappointed because it's cold outside now. it's like, all right, we gotta pack up the patio furniture and because the white stuff's gonna start falling.
It's already here for me, Michael.
Oh yeah, that's right. You said this morning you already got it, right?
Yeah. We can send you some.
So, but you know it. It amazes me, you know, when I talk to like my nieces and my nephews, right, about especially about their kids and everything, it's like that it's all about the video games, you know. I'm like,
yeah,
well, don't they want to go outside and throw the ball around or something, you know? It's like the idea
it's kinda weird, isn't it?
Of playing baseball means plugging some game into some machine and
yeah, but
and like, oh, okay, I thought we were really going to play baseball.
yeah now it's VR and it's kind of odd. Now, you know, with that virtual reality and the way they have the hoods, and I don't know, it might create a little bit more physical activity, but is it enough? That's, you know, yeah, we find ourselves stuffed in a box and talking to ourselves a lot. And really, if we want meaning, I think we have to kind of shift back to getting to know one another and know our family, our friends, our neighbors, our community. It's important. Because really, that's what drives the world, is community. And we don't have to be perfect. And being empathetic towards those that need the understanding, the development to help create a better society. I think we really need to focus on that in our world today.
Yeah. How has Dead America helped you create more community?
Oh, it is so remarkable. I have individuals that just interact with me now, and I missed that for so many years before I started doing this thing. And because people relate to what Dead America means, that feeling of hopelessness and nobody cares, and, you know, finding that it really has brought awareness to rediscovery in many different ways. I find people needing things like this to happen. And Dead America has made myself come out of that, frankly, what we say, FU feeling. And I don't think anybody should feel that way towards another human being. I think we need to really find purpose and meaning and discover who each other are. And that's what Dead America has really done. I've seen so much hope for what I truly want out of it starting to transpire, and people are starting to actually verbalize it out there and share us. So a community is forming, and it takes time because so many people right now are hurt, discouraged, and feel betrayed, and they're just used to that, what we were talking about earlier, consumerism. Well, you're just here to sell me something. I don't want to sell you anything. Actually, I want to try to give you as much as possible. I will give you as much as humanly possible to help you identify your own inner strength and who you truly are. Because that's where you're going to find strength and wisdom in yourself. And discovering you are never going to know everything. And you need other people to actually exist. This is a discovery that so many people right now need. And that is what's forming out of Dead America. It's a great feeling. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah, I imagine that is a great feeling when you start to find that community building around you and everything, right?
Yeah.
And you're joined in with something, and something good, you know?
So, yes. Yeah.
What was the first sign that you know, you realize that it really is building into something really cool?
Well, that would have been about 2019, 2018. A company out of Canada actually reached out to me and said, "We like what you're doing." And, you know, they sponsored me. It felt great to actually know that somebody was listening to what I was saying instead of just babbling on the microphone into the ether.
Yeah.
So, yeah, because it is. You wonder that so many times. Am I even connecting? And when they reach out that first time, it was a shock. I did not expect it. I thought we were too far gone to start making connections and understanding who is saying what, and it took me a long time to really discover how to present myself, because I was so mad and angry and discouraged. I felt hopeless. So discovering that first individual was a life changer for me, because at that point I was on a slippery slope to no place, and as soon as they reached out, that sparked, hey, people are listening to you. You had better start getting your act together and learn how to do this, because there's a platform there, and what you push is what you're going to receive. So what do I want to push? I want to push positivity. I want to push hope. I want to push that people helping people connection. Don't expect something from somebody because you help them. Just do it. And that's life changing. You'll feel so much out of it, and your growth will start happening. Give what you can when you can. Don't feel obligated and don't feel pressured. Just learn to be a caring, giving person.
Yeah. Yeah. That is well said. I don't think that's the bottom line truth right there, you know?
Yes.
What do you? I mean, there's a lot of stuff happened here in between two countries, and it's mirroring each other between the U.S. and Canada. You know, the politics. The protests. You guys are in the middle of a bunch of elections for Senate and Congress and all that kind of stuff, and there's a lot of issues on the table around human rights and how people are supposed to live. We're going to throw that in quotation marks, supposed to live, because supposed to live is something that you're trying to teach with Dead America, you know. So what do you think of what's going on with the politics and everything?
I feel like we're back in the fifth grade. You know, we're not even at high school with this, but I do feel that with the election that just happened, we're still actually getting the election results in. Mm-hmm. But there was a presumed red wave going to happen. The Republicans were going to take both House and the Senate, And I was really setting back and watching this kind of because you had endorsements from Donald Trump to many of these candidates. And then you've had endorsements from Vice President Mike Pence. And there's a split in that party right there. This is an interesting thing that I see along party lines, especially in the Republican side right now. I think we're seeing a shift in that we don't want that mentality of hate and, you know, putting each other against each other. The wave did not happen like they projected. And it falls short on the Donald Trump side, on the Republican end of it. This tells you a lot. You know, I can tell you that with Donald Trump, the way he stirs up animosity and stuff, I think it backfired. And the vote is actually saying this. So my prediction here is you're going to see a possible Trump run. I don't know with the outcomes of all of these failed endorsements. Possibly a Mike Pence run towards the 2024 election, because I've been seeing people kind of going towards Mike Pence. That would be meaningful. Now, I have nothing against Donald Trump other than the way he presents himself. I think he needs to be a little more empathetic towards people. So there's a need for a change, and I really think that this election cycle has showed there is a change coming. It's really along the lines of down the middle, and that's what people are actually looking for.
Well, that's down the middle is kind of good, you know.
Yes.
Because yes. I honestly don't think that we need to be too far left or too far right myself. I preach up here in Canada, the political system is a little bit different, but we just had municipal elections up here, and I was out there preaching to people. It's like, yeah, go out there and vote, get as many people as you can to drag people to the polls if you need to get them to vote. But what we need is not a single mind. What we need is... Yes. is a bunch of minds to come together, and that's going to be more moderate and more down the middle than it is going to be left or right, you know?
Yeah, that's right. So, and another bad thing that's been happening, a trend that has been developing, is this violence in politics.
Yeah,
we have to maintain control, and we have to really educate ourselves in how politics works. If you're going to go storm the Capitol, you'd better understand how politics actually works and how elections work, because I think a lot of the people were misinformed and they were just fired up, ready to go. And when you get that mentality going, that can cause major deficiencies in many way. But I really think that we have to focus on getting people educated and understanding why it's so important to be involved with our elections, our politics in general. Go out there and become a school board member. Go out there and become a commissioner, whatever it takes, mm-hmm. Get involved and understand how the process works, how committees work, how your constitution works, more importantly. So yeah. I just think there's a lot of I don't even want to say that. I think there's a lot of undereducated people about the topics going off more than they should. Educate yourself, get informed, and get involved in a meaningful fashion. And that means talk with people, change people's minds through conversation, not radical violence. That's not good change. That's actually tyrannical, and you don't want that sort of change. You want a democratic system that's meaningful.
Yeah. It's when it becomes meaningful, there's it becomes equalized, you know, and everybody can have their own piece, equal piece of the pie.
Yes, so. And that's truly what it's about. You know, there's an abundance on this planet, and the focus is usually on major cities, and that's where the populace tends to congregate,
yeah,
because it's quick, it's easy, and it's convenient. So you don't find rural people anymore because it is a little tougher. You have to think a little harder. You have to do for yourself a little more. So I think we really need to wake up and find ourselves. Know what you are capable of. Because truly, when you set your mind to it, you can do anything. And that's the important factor here.
That's a great message. Right there. That is a great message.
We got to find ourselves.
Yeah. And with that, I scanned through, of course, Apple Podcasts, because you're there, and and I scanned through some of the episodes and everything, and some of the names of people that you've attracted to be able to interview them. Who was some of your favorites?
Oh boy, there's so many. The one that I really like, I guess, would be Carl DeLew, because he wants truth. And you have, I just have so many that I've done. I hate to put out favorites because they're all my favorite. You've got Branch Eisel coming on. I've got some great individuals coming up that are going to be very strong and passionate messages. But I don't know. The very favorite, I guess, would be the Tracy Maxfield episode. And that's because it was my first real true conversation with somebody that really meant something, and it was about Bully Side. The episode is called Bully Side with Tracy Maxfield, and she fights against bullying in the children. Our children tend to be bullied so much in school and all of that. This lady went through a depressive episode and was bullied herself through the workplace, and she just doesn't like bullies. And I think we need more people like that. So, yeah. There's way too many to say my favorites.
Yeah.
I say they're all good. because As I do each and every interview, I refine my skills, I learn new things, and more importantly, I know more about people. Yeah. And that makes me understand the world that I live in better. So, yeah, I really don't have favorites, but there are those that I like to highlight once in a while.
Yeah. Bowling is one that we like to highlight here also. When we can, you know. There's no need for bullying, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and you know, let's talk about Julia. Julia Christina, she was one of my early episodes also. She just came out with this book, Drive Your Own Darn Bus. My wife and I, we picked this up, and we're going through it together as a workbook. And each week we go through a chapter, and we break it down, and we put the meanings behind this book into our lives. And we're just rediscovering ourselves, and it's a great thing that Julia does, because she's putting people back together and healthy boundaries being set, and it just makes you a stronger, more understanding person. So Julia was a great one.
Yeah. Yeah, that sounds like, it also sounds like a really, really great message. Yeah. I like that. Drive your own darn bus.
Drive your own darn bus.
Yeah.
And it is truly a fascinating book. It helps you discover, and it gives you journal prompts and little activities that you complete in the book. And it really makes you dive in and discover who you are. And are you driving your own darn bus? That's...
Yeah. You know what I thought? Yeah. I think it's really cool, though, is you said that you and your wife are doing it together.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
My wife and I.
That's something that we don't hear often enough anymore. That couples doing stuff together.
Yes. So. You need to. You really need to know who your partner is. And my relationship did not start until I got truthful. And that means those embarrassing little things that you're afraid to tell your wife about who you really are, get in there and hash it out and be truthful, because that's when dynamic things start happening in your relationship. And I've been with my wife since 1983. That's a while. And I'm more in love today with that woman than I was when I first met her. And believe me, when I first met her, she was a nice looking woman. And I love her more today. And I think she's more beautiful today with age, because she's put me on the spot so many times and said, really? So having somebody that's willing to say, hey, slow down, you know, I'm not gonna go for that just right yet, let's talk about it.
Yeah.
And yes, get involved with your partner in the most intimate ways, and I'm talking know them, know their best days, their worst days, and work with it. When you're not having a good day, acknowledge it. Make sure you tell your partner, I'm not having a good day, so if I offend you today, please forgive me up front and let me know. And it will help me back off and take charge of my feelings and my emotions and my own things that I might be going through that day.
Yeah.
Every day I wake up, I give my wife a kiss, I go in, I wake her up because I know what time she wakes up, so I go in and I try to, hey, good morning, I love you. We start the day with a kiss and good morning, I love you. And another big tip about relationship, try not to go to bed angry. If you have to go and talk until 5 o'clock in the morning and you have to be to work at 8, be that committed to that relationship, because then that person knows you're there thick and thin, and boy, it gets thick sometimes. So be ready for the thin, and you'll do okay.
Yeah. All right. So we're starting to run out of time here. So what's the future for Dead America?
There's some good things, actually. I can't announce right now. I'm under embargo, but come January 1st, we've got some exciting news that we're going to release, and it's all because of great people that come on our show, share their stories, and most of all, the great listeners that make it happen. You know, if nobody listened, I don't think anybody would do it. But one listen, that's great. You're changing one life.
Yeah.
And that's enough. And if that's enough, when those big numbers do start happening for you, and they will, it just makes you handle it way better. So know your why and keep it a passion, and it will just happen. Big things are happening for Dead America. There's been so many times I just wanted to say I'm done with it. You know, it's not worth my time. But you know the feeling. when you hit that wall, you got to say, no, that one person, I'm there for them. Yeah. And because I give them meaning, that actually has meaning for me. So discover that. Be passionate about why. Why are you doing this? Is it for a buck? Because if it is, you might not make it. Make it your passion, and then the bucks might just start rolling in. You never know. So, yeah, it's all about the why. We've got some good things coming for Dead America, and we're excited about it. We want everybody to be involved, and we don't discriminate.
Yeah.
We love everybody.
So everybody should visit the blog at, what is it, deadamerica.website, right?
That is correct.
And you're also on, I found you on Apple Podcasts, but what other ones, what are some of the other?
Every place.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're on Spotify, we're on Amazon, yeah, there's things that I don't even realize we're on. And another thing, when you are podcasting and you're looking at those numbers, they really don't mean much, because you never know how many people are truly getting your message.
Yeah,
it's fabulous. They'll reach out. It takes years, but they'll reach out. Just keep going, because it shows you have commitment, and that's what people are looking for. People that really commit to something.
Yeah, commitment's where it's at. All right. Thank you, Ed. It's been great talking to you today, and thank you, everybody, for listening. And please do make sure you hit that subscribe button and share us. Share us with all your friends. All right. Thanks a lot. Okay.
Turn. Recording stopped.
There we go. I lost
all
my
right,
mouse.
Michael.
there it is. There.
This show has been produced by Depictions Media. Please contact us at depictions.media for more information.